figures like a rocket and Kristen the Invisible Woman, who constructs invisible force fields that support the addition crystal in the back there, of course, the Thing breaking down all obstacles through sheer force of will, and finally Mr. Fantastic, who leaps between worlds. It's a great team, these Fantastic Four that I have with me, and I'm so grateful to them and to Craig and to the team from Occidental College who are creating this larger community for us to share the work with. To me, there's a beautiful irony in this. We are taking this printed work and putting it online, and as a consequence of that, taking relationships that have been chiefly virtual and mediated by computers into flesh and blood encounters, and I love that. As the six of us have been working together now for some years, and we've never all met together live in one place, so that's a big thrill to be here and to have the virtual become real in that way. Again, I'm going to try to keep this short. We'll have some Q&A about Vetusta Monumenta, which I will try to introduce as economically as I can. My four collaborators will speak briefly after the Q&A about other digital editions, because although we'd like to think that ours is the only one, there are seven others in the works right here in this room, and one way to try to figure out this new category of the digital edition is to look at different examples of it, and so I hope to do some of that. I think as we transition then to the book fair, it would be nice to have somebody come up here and sort of point out each of the seven stations and say what they are before we disperse into looking at them. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. So again, thank you for being here. I'd like to start with the edition itself. Which we have been building over several years now using the Scalar platform, which probably those of you here all know that Craig Dietrich is the lead developer for this platform, and many other projects, including some I think that are featured here, are being built on the same platform. I like to think of a digital edition as a book unbound. And one of the things that I learned early on in working on Vetusta Monumenta is it's not a book at all. It's a print series masquerading as a set of bound volumes. One way in which the edition unbinds the volumes again into the prints, the individual prints which were published gradually, two or three per year over a period of many years, and that's the way the user of our edition, when equipped with the proper technical skills, such as operating a mouse, encounters them. And before getting into any type of factual background about Vetusta Monumenta and the edition, I simply want to take you on a little tour of the prints that the five of us have been working on just recently. We sort of took advantage of the opportunity to finish off a set of commentaries and make them live. And so you can see here that in addition to the print itself, on top of the print itself, the features that we have to make it accessible and useful to readers are the transcription of the text on the plate, which for the first 45 years of the series is all there is. Subsequent to that, then there are also letterpress commentaries that accompany the plates. Translation, which is necessary throughout the period that Latin was being used, of that text. Brief accounts, capsule descriptions of the plate itself, and of the object that's depicted on the plate, in this case, the ruins of Furness Abbey in northwest England. And then finally, an account of the state of that object or monument before we launch into the commentary itself, which we had initially sought to limit to 1,000 words and which, with no space or cost restrictions, is ballooning to larger and larger sizes. So that's the scholarly format of what may or may not become the standard edition of Vetusta Monumenta. We like to think that it will. That's what we told the NEH, anyway. And they're certainly expecting it to be a scholarly edition. The value-added features that Scalar is able to offer us, thanks to this long-standing collaboration, I can only point out a few of them. But one is the image itself contains metadata. So if you're looking at the image, you're able to click that details tab there. And because of the form in which the image file is uploaded to the site, all of this metadata is carried with it. And so you can scroll through to find out about the creation of the scans, the subject matter of the prints themselves, the medium in which they're executed, the creator, the date, all of this without bothering with all of the prose if you want. You can go straight to the metadata categories. And that was something that really Kristen, our technical editor, and Craig developed together specifically for our project. There are other features that are used more broadly, I think, across Scalar projects. And one is this image annotation, where you can pull up a note on a subject. In this case, the Second Duke of Montevue, who commissioned the drawing on which this engraving was based, and you can pull up this nice portrait. All kinds of different media files can be embedded by way of annotation. Most importantly, though, the image itself, this plate was engraved by George Virtue and published on the 600th anniversary of the founding of Furness Abbey on the site, Barrow and Furness in what's now Cumbria in northwest England. And my home field is British Romantic literature, and so I know this site well as a quintessential Romantic ruin. Wordsworth wrote actually more poetry about Furness Abbey than he did about Tintern Abbey, and the archive of paintings and engravings and etchings from really the period 1772 forward is enormous. Includes many named artists. This print gives you a snapshot of Furness Abbey before it became a romantic ruin. And working with it, to me, allowed a really interesting intervention into the reception of the ruins, into the whole idea of historical distance. Over here on the right, and now we'll watch Open Sea Dragon at work. You see something that you will not find on any of the romantic paintings and engravings of this site, because it's from the wrong period. It's a late 17th century manor house with a formal garden. Doesn't fit into a romantic ruin at all, and in fact, it's been torn down. So in a small way, that's still very salient in this context, you can see how these prints do the work of preserving monuments and objects in a state in which they're no longer accessible to us. And so in that very simple sense, what our edition strives to do is to augment the preservation effort that the antiquaries were making to begin with these prints. Many other things that you wouldn't see in romantic images. This is a working landscape. We're looking at the east end of the Abbey Church in Furness. The morning sun is behind us. There are these deer that, because it's being used as a deer park, my student likes to refer to them as the happy deer. They may not know they're imminent about their imminent demise. The hunters are in the image. There's a watermill here, which is a modern feature that makes this a working landscape. And you see also the second story of this chapter house, if you can see my cursor there, less of it has fallen down at that point than it is today if you look at photographs. Another small example. I want to zoom in especially before I move on to the next image on these two figures. You can see the draftsman at work. And what I think is especially important about this print is the 27th in the series. It's the first time that the draftsman is included in order to verify the eyewitness authenticity of the representation. That's not a new convention in scientific illustration, but it's a rarity in antiquarian printmaking in England at this time. That figure, and also the person here in the dead center of the image, who's gazing down the 287-foot perspective of the ruined nave, which is a little bit too conveniently closed by a big tree. That figure, and we can use the term actually more associated with German romantic painting of Rückenfigur to describe this figure whose back is toward us and who stands in as our proxy viewing the scene, stands at the junction point between objects and history. And that's a space that I didn't even really realize existed before I started working on this project. I firmly believe that in calibrating our own historical distance from any kind of monument or material remain, looking at somebody else from an equally distant period contemplating that same remain creates an analogy that enables that space to open up, the space between history and the object. Let's look at a couple of others. So this is what I've been working on, and on the subject of preservation, maybe the modern manor house that's no longer there, that's documented by this print, is not so important. But we turn next to the image that Matthew Reed has been working on, which depicts a structure that was completely destroyed, except for the north wall, right, Matthew, adjoining the cathedral itself. This is an ancient chapel adjoining the bishop's palace at Hereford Cathedral in the west of England. You can see we're trying to keep things standard. So you have, again, your transcription. No translation is needed in this case because the text is English. The capsule descriptions of the plate and the object and the longer commentary. But in fact, as these books, which we'll have the opportunity, thanks to Jane, to look at in the flesh at the end of the talk, become unbound in this way, and you start to see how heterogeneous these objects are, they really require different techniques of presentation. So one of the things that we're struggling with in trying to create a standard edition is how standard can we really make it if the objects that are being depicted on the prints come from a 1400-year span and range from coins to castles. That's one of the problems arising from this edition that I'm very interested in discussing. You'll see that the image is dated 1737. The chapel is called ancient, because it's in the Romanesque style of architecture, and that's what makes it, even in the form of a print, a vital act of preservation to print it in this way, because scholars still use it to study the chapel. And it's one of the first plates to be all English. The Batista Monumenta ran for nearly 200 years, and it presents an opportunity to trace over time how the past was studied in a given context as standards changed, as scholarly language changed from Latin to English, as the social class composition of the site of antiquaries changed over time. This has a lovely Rococo frame, as I learned from Matthew's commentary. It has banderoles containing English text. It has a ground plan. And it was sketched by William Stukeley, one of the founder, pioneer members of the revived Society of Antiquaries in 1717-1718, who stated in the Articles of Incorporation that still govern the Society to this day, that its mission was to collect and print all the ancient monuments that come into their hands, which to my mind is a fascinating declaration. I think we don't tend to think of monuments as small enough to fit in the palm of your hand. It translates the act of printing them. And in this case, Stukeley had been there. He was one of the traveling antiquaries. He was one of the people on the scene, like that guy looking down the nave at Furness Abbey. He recorded this in 1737. It was destroyed, and so they decided it was time to engrave that drawing that he had made when he was on the site. 16 years earlier. To complete the survey of the four most recent additions to our volume, before I try to give you some of the larger background on it, I'd like to show you one now that Crystal has been working on. And that is here. So far we've seen two architectural subjects. We've seen a ruined abbey church, and we've seen a chapel adjacent to a cathedral. This is a document. And it's a contentious subject, believe it or not, in the history of antiquarianism, whether the antiquary's important contribution was to remediate documents, archives, or material culture, objects. If the latter is the case, they would be noble ancestors of the scientific discipline of archaeology. And so this is one of many cases where actually they were working with a document, and the standard insider histories of the discipline don't like this set of prints for this reason. Crystal, in writing her commentary, which is not yet online because of the massive formatting and presentation challenges that poses to have a commentary that's on a series of six. Is it six or seven, Crystal?
Six.
So I'll just tell you one of the things I learned from reading Crystal's new commentary. I think this is an amazing discovery. The English barons wrote this letter to the Pope, to Pope Boniface VIII, in 1301. It was probably never sent. There was a power struggle going on. But to make it official, all of the signatories had to have their seals attached. And the original still has attached to it, as you can actually see in the draftsman's note on the last plate, the wax impressions of the seals, which bear the coats of arms of all of the barons who signed the letter. He says, what does he say? All these seals were fastened. Can you read that? Were fastened to the said charter, or letter with silk strings. But wax is delicate stuff. You pour the hot wax on the document, you take the brass or metal seal matrix and impress the image. But by the time the print was made, that wax had deteriorated to the point where in many cases the motifs couldn't even be recognized. And it was for that reason that Virtue, the engraver, who was another founder member of the Society of Antiquaries, didn't work with the originals themselves. It seems very unscientific. He actually made the engraving from a copy of the original, because it was a reliable copy that was done at a time when the wax was much less decayed. And that enabled Virtue then in his engraving to give us incredible detail on these coats of arms and the seals. And thanks to Open Sea Dragon again, this zooming tool, you're able to see the individual strokes of graver's burin as he engraved into the copper these lines. I think that's fascinating. Finally, Katarina's most recent work. Katarina has become our castles specialist. One of the big challenges for this project is classifying the kinds of things that are engraved in this collection. The cliche about antiquaries is that they're amateurs, they're dabblers. The Oxford English Dictionary defines antiquarianism as a taste and or knowledge of antiquities. The and or is very slippery there. To the untrained eye, these collections look incredibly miscellaneous and heterogeneous. There's no rhyme or reason. There's no apparent principle why these objects were chosen for engraving, how they relate to each other. Their scale ranges from minute to vast. Their date ranges from late antiquity to modern. So we're working hard on that. Fortunately, there was one person who made an attempt in the late 18th century to classify. He said, okay, there are six categories of things that were engraved. There are coins, there are castles, there are churches, there are portraits, there's miscellaneous, and there's antiquities. So this here is clearly a castle. This again, like the seals we were just looking at, is not based on anything like an original. It's based on a 17th century drawing that was made when more of the castle was still standing. It had been completely destroyed at the end of the Civil War, isn't that right?
Yeah, very soon after the Civil War, late 1640s.
1640s.
The drawing is a 16th century drawing.
16th century drawing.
Yeah.
So, one of the antiquaries discovered this cache of Elizabethan drawings of castles, and Virtue decided to engrave these for the series, or really collectively as a body, they decided. And you can imagine, with a castle that's been demolished for so long, that it was a challenge for Contarina to find identifications for all of the structures that are represented. It's a complicated castle. It has a lot of towers, 8 of them, I think. Right, an unusual layout, I like to think of that as a value added. You might look at this print as you're leafing through the volume. You might happen to be an expert on castles, and you might be able to come up with some of this stuff on your own. But if you navigate to this online edition of this particular print, you have all of that at your fingertips. And again, Kristen has used the visual annotation tool and has used many other onboard features of Scalar to make that, some of that, apparent. So the thing that our reviewers liked, I think that everybody really likes the best, is the zooming tool. I can sort of do this with a piece of paper, but it's not exactly the same. So the resolution is terrific. We have very information-rich TIFF files. Of course, those are too large to be streamed online, but Open Sea Dragon tool renders the image as tiles, which can then be reconfigured as the zooming occurs. I'd like to show you now that I'm not very literate at all in Southern digital form, but we have this visual literacy, if that's the proper name for it, which is a sort of screen-to-brain transfusion that we do nowadays, and I say this as the worried parent of a 13-year-old who is nursing a little bit of borderline screen addiction. Therefore, because we have these neural pathways now that enable us to transfuse directly, I'm going to click through these slides very quickly that have background fact about the background facts about the society. And because I'm a Mac user, I can't even find the presentation mode
up top
button.
Mm-hmm. Over just a little bit to your right.
This one?
Mm-hmm.
To start with, the antiquaries' own conception of themselves as a literary institution. The modern day, if you consider 1956 to be modern day, antiquaries' insistence that no, they were proto-archaeologists, and it's only their scientific legacy that's of value. We have 3 literary scholars on our team, and so we kind of favor the originalist reading. You can also see, though, that the Society of Antiquaries has never been given to modesty from that last quotation. They too have superpowers. There's a way of telling the story of the Society of Antiquaries through the concept of a heroic age, and incredibly important work was done by individuals. And initially, they were marginal characters working on what seems to us now to be a central subject, national history. It wasn't then. None of the founders had university degrees, because they were religious dissenters, in fact, Catholics, crypto-Catholics, Unitarians. First president of the society, Peter Leneve, who was a Unitarian, has on his tombstone, godless atheist. That was how people regarded him. And so you can see a sort of a shift when 100 years later, people were reasonably complaining the society has grown too polite, too fashionable, and too rich, until finally, by the 20th century, most of the fellows of the Society of Antiquaries are academics. The other way of telling the story, which I tried to do a little bit through pointing to the people in the prints and through the network that's created between the objects represented and the people in there, is a more collective story. And I'll try to point to some of the marks of corporate authorship and collective agency, institutional agency, that we can read in the prints themselves. These are all things that that need to be explained, or that maybe we'll arrive at explanations of in the course of our conversation. I mentioned preservation as the mission of the society, which they saw themselves initially as executing through the prints, later on by amassing a physical collection. That's very important. I haven't yet mentioned so much the way in which objects become actors through these prints. And that's one way of understanding antiquarianism, I think a very useful way, unlike history, which tends to be a narrative about nations or about social groups. Antiquarian scholarship is illustrated, and it's focused on some dimension of material culture. And documents should be included in that, must be included, as we've seen. And what's constructed then is a visual verbal narrative. The object types, I talked about this a little bit. The Society of Antiquaries has a very long and complicated history. And to go through the slides, I have two of them, and to make sense of them would take more time than we currently have. I had a wonderful conversation with Professor Horowitz, who had to leave, who works on early modern antiquarianism, and there's a great specimen of that there. These 18th century antiquaries who produced the work that we're editing were consciously reviving that humanist tradition. So there is this long trajectory. And since the Royal Charter was granted to them in 1751, there's a modern tradition too. We've all been to the Society of Antiquaries and done research there in Burlington House on Piccadilly in London. Matthew, who's clearly the most distinguished scholar among us, has even been elected to fellowship in the Society. The story continues on. It took all of the learned societies everywhere a long time to start admitting women. And that act of excluding women members was one of many forms of institution formation that was available to societies like this at this time, whether it's the Academy of Sciences or the Académie Française or the Royal Society. I'm going to point out in a minute contributions that women actually were making to the project in the course of the 18th century. That 1921 date, though, has an anecdote attached to it, which is that the president of the society at that time said, we've got to start admitting women, and it's not, it's for their money. It's not for their because this was post-World War I Britain, and times were tough. So that's just a very frank admission on his part. I was doing this slide and I was thinking, do I really have to explain why the Society of Antiquaries was based in London? London's full of records. But it is interesting to look at it in the context of all these provincial societies. There were places that were hard to get to in England from London at that time, like Furness Abbey. And if you look at the contents of the first volume especially, you'll find that many remote places, especially Yorkshire, are represented in the plates. So clearly it was a way of virtual transport to these sites. This is the question that drives us crazy. And I don't want to go there. I would say, sort of touches on the raison d'etre of the project. Why do we think it's worth not only digitizing? I hate that word because I've had so many grant proposals shot down by people who say, why not just use Google Books? That's what digitizing means in that vocabulary. To create a digital edition, meaning to create a framework in which the object makes sense. That's the traditional part of how edition, the word edition, is defined that I identify with for this project. Some of this material I've already touched on. I really do think these prints open new pathways to understanding the history and theory of objects And I've emphasized that a little bit in my remarks about the plates that we've seen. This is one of those old school historical resources that I think really puts to the test newfangled claims about object-oriented ontology and about object orientation in humanistic scholarship. This is a text that facilitates that engagement. You have to decide how serious you are about the objects to do it. I'm going to use slides for this part because we've looked at the edition and I'm starting to run a little over 30 minutes. Plate one, the very first plate. And if you go to the Society of Antiquaries website today, sal.org.uk, you'll see that this lamp became the seal, as it were, the emblem of the society, and remains to this day. It shall not be extinguished. Informally, on the team, we call it the lamp of knowledge. They thought it was Roman. Turned out to be a medieval Jewish Sabbath lamp. Each one of these objects has a wonderful story behind it. This is the first place, do you see that okay? Where the antiquary appears. And this figure does a lot of different kinds of work in the image. He indicates the scale of the monument. He models a kind of admiration, a kind of wonder. Some say, and this particular plate happens to be one of those that's attracted scholarly attention, and there are a few articles and chapters out on it. Some say he's actually there to show that the object has been tamed and domesticated. It's a single human figure that enters into the print. And as you trace the prints forward through time, you get multiple figures. I'm going to skip over this. Published at the expense of the Society of Antiquaries, is engraved into almost every plate. And it's one of the ways in which they signify their corporate agency. You'll recognize this. The portraits of living antiquaries that get introduced is another way in which human actors enter into the scene of these prints. The thing about Tanner, and Crystal is working with her students on this plate, and so maybe later on there'll be a chance for her to talk about working with students with this project. I've worked one-on-one with a lot of students on it, never with a class. What I know about this bishop is that he was the only bishop who was willing to meet in a tavern, because in the beginning years of society, they met in a tavern. And so maybe it's out of gratitude for that. You recognize the object there in the lower right-hand corner, which we just saw. So there's a way in which the history of institutions starts to cycle through and take shape in these prints, which I find utterly fascinating. On your left, you see a book by Leland with some of those seals dangling out of it. He was an Elizabethan antiquary. And so they're in that visual act claiming descent from the Elizabethan antiquaries. That's all just in the border of the image. I love this one, Winchester Cross, Plate 61, Volume 1. Sean Silver's working on it, right? Because there are multiple figures. It happens to be a market cross. There's buying and selling going on. There's buying and selling of fruit. On your right, you see the artist who's made the ground plan, and it's a ground plan of the monument itself that we're looking at. The ground plan in his hands is the plan of that cross. And the other man seems to be a patron. So money's going to change hands somehow, you can tell. And so this action, I would say, is not peripheral to the central, the monument on the print, but is telling the story of the monument's creation. Portrait of the Elizabethan antiquary Robert Cotton, showing another way in which the history of the society is integrated into the projects. This rather dour looking gent, the caption claims that he was 87 at the time the portrait was taken, so maybe he had reason to be dour. He was the fifth member of the revived Society of Antiquaries. And like all of them, was what we would today call professional class. He was an archivist in the Tower of London. In the frame of the image, you see him at work in this tiny little archive. Requires no comment. It's too beautiful for words. I was going to talk about the role of women. The volume on the left, the first plate in it that Jane has brought, shows a plate from this series in volume two. It's the first one where a woman is named as a contributor, 1786. I'm going to show you her signature. The draftsperson's name is always placed in the lower left-hand corner. And because this is post-1763, there's letterpress commentary. Oh, I didn't include that. Shoot. This is a different version of it. Well, so it's not only her drawing that was engraved, but also a long letter that she wrote, which is prefaced by an explanation that ignorant peasants had destroyed this mosaic as soon as it was brought to light by digging. And so once again, the plate becomes the only record of the monument of Roman Britain. And Downes's letter itself says that a drunken clown, in quotes, carried off the mosaic in pieces the very night after it was exposed. And so it's a really interesting case where the contribution by this lady is very substantial, and there are other cases of women contributing that are of interest. We're going to fast forward into the 19th century. We've been looking at copper engraving. This is a hand-colored engraving, and it's life-size, and depicts a fragment of the Bayeux Tapestry, and the artist in question writes a lot about how huge an advance in technology this is in terms of authenticity, in terms of what we might think of as objectivity. But that's nothing compared to the color lithography that we see being used near the end of the series, which enabled an artifact, in this case, Bishop's buskin, to be placed in contact with the stone, so that a kind of a near photographic authenticity is established. We're a long way from here. We're most of the way through volume one, so we're up right around 1740, 1750. Our goal for the NEH-funded project is to get to the end of volume three, so to get through the 18th century. We're hoping to find more collaborators to pick up the work and carry it on through the 19th. I'm going to end my remarks here. I'm going to first of all invite questions and comments from the audience, which my collaborators, depending on the question, will also jump in on.
Matthew, and I'm curious, seems obvious for the monuments, but I'm wondering if other kinds of objects come into that map view at all? And if so, how?
What's the quickest way to navigate to that, Chris?
If you go to volume one and then click there, then
there you go,
map view. Yeah.
Is there a way to navigate directly from the plate?
From the plate, it's tagged. So
it's tagged. That's what I was remembering.
Can you click on one of those? I'm just curious what.
So this is probably Furness Abbey right here, right?
There are multiple. Yes. If you click on Lancashire objects.
So this will take us back to Furness Abbey again.
Yes.
But first it'll take us to a list of the
mm-hmm.
two.
Because there are
things
multiple.
That are. Oh, Lancaster Castle, of course. That's the other one.
Oh, I see. So there's now a page that would include
mm-hmm.
all the objects.
Yes. Every once in a while, they group things together, and the way that the tag works, you get one geolocation. So I had to kind of jerry-rig a way of grouping things together. But in some instances where like there's one object in one location, then clicking on the pin will take you directly to that commentary.
Cool.
If that makes
sense. If it's only one object.
Yeah. Or if they're far enough apart where they have
here in Yorkshire, they're all on top of each other.
Yeah.
So it can be hard to access them. So there is that. I mean, this is something that will be really important in developing the interactivity of the project.
Yeah, no, that's great. And then my other question just more has to do with, I mean, it's super impressive and honest to goodness, you know, like magnificent that you're finding time to do this work, you know, knowing what all the other, you know, work of professing in universities involves. And I'm wondering how you structure grant writing for a big collaborative project like this. So as part of what that grant is for is time for you to do this, or how do you structure that in terms of a grant, you know, for six people working?
Yeah.
So is it course releases, or how does one do that?
Absolutely, there is that, and it's in part because, as you say, to devote enough time to something like this, something else has to drop out temporarily. So we got, Crystal is the co-PI on the grant, and so the two of us, for this three-year period, are spearheading the project. Well, I have to say, our other collaborators are really working just as hard. So we got those teaching releases. We have each of us a PhD level or a graduate research assistant, doing commentary research, doing a lot of the daily work.
So it funded assistants.
Funded,
right?
Research assistants.
Excellent.
It's funding meetings. So there was a grant contributed to this event, although Occidental has also been very generous. Mm-hmm. There's going to be an event in London that it's contributing to. So it's, and that's important because we're so far flung. So
right.